Well, hello everybody. Welcome back to the BBC Learning English Live Friday quiz. We've got another great quiz for you this week. I am your host, Dylan, and we have some great questions for you. Now, as always, we've got vocabulary questions, grammar questions, idioms, and a very special guest who's going to talk to us about slang. Now, today is the start of the Olympics, hooray, which I am very excited about. I'm a big sports fan, so I'll be looking forward to the sprint, the hurdles, the high jump in particular. What sports are you looking forward to seeing in the Olympics? Because today's theme is the Olympics and sports, and that's what we're going to look at. Now, let's go to the comments and say hello to everybody. Hello to Alfred from Ecuador. Hello, Alfred. We got Maha says hello. Hi. We've got Rahul saying hello. Mary Joseph. Hi, how are you? I'm good. It's Friday. The sun is shining. So I'm feeling very good. How are you guys today? We got Arseno. Hello from Turkey. And hello from M. So we're going to get started pretty soon. But before we begin, there are just a few ground rules I want to go through with you. Whoops, let me take down Im's comment. We got Ong. Hi, Ong. Okay, and a few rules. So there are 8 questions. We do the questions at the start, and then we look at the answers and explain a little bit at the end. So stick around, because that's the important part. It is just for fun. There are no prizes. It's the weekend is nearly here. It's Friday. We're here to improve our English and to learn some new words and to enjoy ourselves. There are no official prizes, just a sense of pride. And please like, comment, and share. If you're having a good time, hit that like button. Put your answers into the comment box and share with your friends and family, colleagues, teachers, students. The more, the merrier. Now, are you ready? Okay, let's take a look. See who else we've got here. So, Noah's saying, this is a funny show. Thank you. Now, is it funny or fun? Or is it both? Let's hope it's both, yeah? We've got Neymar saying, hi from Iran. Hi. Hello, Toru from Japan. Hello. How do you feel about the Olympics being held? I know there's some controversy this year because of COVID and everything. How do you feel? Are you excited? And we got Tanya. Hello, you are ready. Perfect. Okay, so let's begin with round one. And at the start of every round, I'll give a little ring of the bell to mean we're moving on to the next round. Okay, question number one. Oops. Is a vocabulary question, and it's about sport. Now, which of these is not an Olympic sport? So they are all sports, but which of them is not an Olympic sport? Okay, so get your answers coming into the comment section and let me know. Have you played any of these sports? Do you like any of these sports? Are you excited to watch them in the Olympics this year? Okay, so we've got Siddharthan going fencing. Okay, we've got Salufu going for rugby. Lakshmi Devi is in rounders. What could it be? So rugby. Okay, so I like to see this is quite a nice variety of questions here. So moving on to question number two. Okay, question number two is an idiom question. And it's asking you, which idiom means to do something really well? If you do a job really, really well, do we say A, knock it out of the park? B, smash it out of the game? C, hit it out of the stadium? Or D, bat it out of the arena? Which of these idioms means to do something really well, to do a good job on something? And if you're feeling very confident, can you give me an example with this sentence. Okay, so get your answers coming in. We've got hit it out of the stadium. C says Akshat. We have got another one. Is it Boba? Not exactly sure. Saying C. We've got Chuan saying bat it out of the arena. So another one with quite a wide variety of answers, which is what I love to see. When you're not sure, and when there's lots of different answers, that's when I'm very happy, because there's more to learn, okay? There's more opportunity to learn if you're not sure. And we'll take a look at one more who says, Tamida says, knock it out of the park. Now, do you agree or disagree? Let us know in the comment section. And if you are enjoying, please hit that like button. On we go. Round three. We are flying through this. Okay, round three. On we go. Now, this is one of the more negative aspects of sports and the Olympics and big world championships. Now, what do we call the use of illegal drugs in sports? So when we use drugs that are performance enhancing, that are banned and are not allowed, what do we call that? Do we call it A, eloping, B, moping, or C, doping? A, eloping, B, moping, or C, doping? So the use of banned substances like steroids, what do we call that in sports? Okay, Hyun Unja is going for C, doping, as is VG. Ashraf going for C, doping. Omar saying it's easy, no problem. Okay, how many have you got right so far, Omar? Are you 3 out of 3? I hope so. I want to hear your score at the end. All right. Okay, Shiny, and to anybody who's not sure, if you're not sure, take a guess. Okay, it's multiple choice. Always take a guess. And then, because sometimes you have a gut feeling or it's in the back of your mind, and you can surprise yourself by how many you can get right by just having an educated guess. And Yilin, definitely doping, so very, very confident. All right, lots of people saying hello from around the world. Hi to everybody. Hi to Danila from the Philippines. And hi to Quasar from Pakistan. Hi to everybody who's just joining us. If you have just arrived, this is the BBC Learning English Live Friday English Quiz. We're on question number 3. We do the questions first and we look at the answers and delve into them a little bit more at the end. So stick around. Round 4. Okay, on we go. Round 4. Now we've got a little bit of a grammar question for you here. By the end of the day, the Olympics started. Is it will be, will have, or will have been? So we're looking at an event that is finished by a future date or future point. Okay, I'm sorry guys, I'm going to be back in 1 second. Hold on. How unprofessional. Thanks for bearing with me. Power problems. Whew. Okay. So grammar question. By the end of the day, the Olympics started. Will be, will have, or will have been. What do you think? And as always, if you feel confident, please make your own example sentences and we can look at them together. So nice variety of questions here. Salafu says, will have been C. Josh was going for A. Nagoyan is going for A. And Fizzy Richmond is going for B, will have. And I always like it when you are confident. So C says Estella. Okay. And we got one more. Will have been from Than. Oops. Lots of more coming in. Your comments are flying in the comments section. Okay, on we go to my favorite round, round number five. Now, today we've got a special guest. We've got Paige Neil-Holder, who is a journalist for the BBC and who has written a fantastic article on the BBC News website about slang. So let's say hello to Paige. Hello.
Hi, Dylan. Hello.
Good. Thanks for joining us. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. Nice to be here.
Good, good to hear. And are you looking forward to the Olympics?
Definitely. I mean, it's crazy that it's actually happening after everything that's gone on, but it's great to see that it's finally going ahead.
Okay. Finally, exactly. I'm quite excited about it myself. We all deserve something positive, don't we?
Okay, definitely.
So, Paige, you're here to talk about slang. So could you explain to our audience, what is slang?
Sure. So slang is basically a group of words and phrases that are used to speak in a more informal and casual manner. So I'm sure everyone that's watching, you'll probably have slang words in your own native languages, and it's the same for in English. And it's used more in everyday speech, so in everyday conversations when you're talking to someone. But that doesn't mean it's not used in text, but you'll probably use it more in text messages rather than an email to your colleague. And it's also specific to a group of people. So, for example, over here in the UK, we would use slang words that are different to over in the US.
Okay, and have you got an example of a slang word for the audience, please?
Sure. So a word that is used in English both in the US and over here in the UK is the word sick. So you might know that word to describe vomit or to describe someone who's not feeling very well or is feeling quite ill. But in slang, it has a completely different meaning, and it actually means something more positive. So the word slang would probably the word sick would probably be used to describe something that is cool or amazing. So as an example, I might say, oh, wow, the Olympics are starting today. That's sick. So that's one example.
Sick example. Thank you very much. So just to check, sick in normal everyday use means to be ill or to vomit.
Yeah.
But in slang, it means really good or fantastic.
Yeah, exactly. So like cool or amazing.
Okay. And would you recommend that English language learners study slang?
Definitely. I think it's really, really useful. I mean, as I said, slang is used more in everyday conversations, but I think it's used a lot more than people realize. So, you know, with me, my conversations, they're littered with slang. So I think anyone that's learning English, perhaps you might be looking to visit an English speaking country or even perhaps looking to live in an English speaking country. And it'd be really useful for you to have an idea of these words so that when you have an interaction with someone speaking English, you'll have an idea of what they're saying. But also it might be interesting for you learning English to kind of see the difference between the word that you've learned and how it's been, how the meaning has been changed to use it in terms for slang. So it's just kind of a good idea to get that idea culturally.
Okay. And I can see lots of comments coming in the audience are saying that your lesson is sick. So thank you, Helma.
Thank you.
So it is a quiz. So, and I believe you've got a sports related slang question for us, question number five.
Yep, definitely. I had to keep it in theme with the Olympics and sports. So my question is, what do we say when we've lost a sports match? So is it A, gutted, B, chuffed, or C, knackered? Okay. And England have just lost the Euro, so we can definitely relate to this word.
All right, could you repeat it one more time, nice and slowly, please, Paige?
Yeah. So what do we say when we've lost a sports match? Is it A, gutted, B, chuffed, or C, knackered?
Paige, thank you very much for your question. Lots of comments, lots of positive questions, comments coming in. Thank you for your question. Have a lovely day.
Thank you.
Okay, bye. All right, okay. Hi, everybody. So a little bit of a brief lesson there from Paige about slang. Now, what do you think the answer is? So that was a listening question. There's no slide for you. How was that? Could you get it? Let me know the answer in the comments. And as always, if you are enjoying the lesson, hit that like button. So let's take a look in the comment section where another positive thing. IELTS Cusco says, this girl is sick. Nice example. Amit's going for a different way of saying what answer they think is incorrect. So I'm gutted means disappointed. Okay, do you agree? Okay, Sana Uli understands chuffed. Does it mean disappointed though? That's the big question. And let's take a look. So Jill, how do you write the words Paige mentioned? I will show you at the end. Okay, so when we give the answers, I will write them up there for you so you can see how they are spelled. And Claudia's in. Say hello to me, please. Hello, Claudia. All right. On we go. Onwards and upwards to question number 6. Which is question number 6. This is not multiple choice. So you have to give me the answers. 3 vocabulary words. I'm very, very tight. You have to get all 3 of these words correct to get 1 point. Okay? Spelling doesn't matter, but I want you to get these 3 words to get 1 point. Now, tell me, do you like these sports? Which of these are your favorite? The one on the left is one I used to do very commonly when I was learning to swim. But the other 2 I haven't played so much. So let's take a look at what you've got to say. So Rishab saying 2, archery. Okay, we've got jumping swimming. Is that the correct answer? Do you agree? Let me know in the comments. We've got swimming and volleyball. Okay, it could be swimming, but usually when you jump into the water, there's a name for that sport. So swimming is in the water. When you jump in, it's got a particular name. What could it be? So Lovegood has got archery and volley beach. Okay, I'll give you a click. It's close. It's close. Not quite right, but it's close. All right. And we'll take a look at 1 or 2 more. Volleyball says Jahan. Which one is volleyball and do you agree? So there's 3 sports there. Please name them all 3 to get 1 point. I know. I'm tough. What a teacher, huh? All right. Number 7. Question number 7. Again, a grammar question, really. This is looking at choosing the correct word form to go into the blank space. So some events may be affected by the hot weather conditions. Maybe adverse affected. B, maybe adversely affected. Or C, maybe adversity affected. So do we use the verb, the adverb, or the noun in the blank space there? What do you think? The verb A, adverse, B, the adverb, adversely, or C, the noun, adversity. What do you think? Can you tell me, what does the word mean? What does adversely mean? Or what does adversely, what does adverse, what does adversity mean? Okay, Danilo saying adverse from the Philippines. Enrique is going for adversely. Lots of B's coming in. Jimanan, we've got Sheesh going for B, and Metzli is going for B as well. Well, Fam is going for adversity, and another B from Ishara. Okay, so we're on to our final question. Then we will look at the answers. So final question before the answers on the BBC Learning English quiz. Round 8. Which phrasal verb means to hit someone and make them lose consciousness? So is it A, knock down, B, knock out, or C, knock over? So a phrasal verb that means that when you hit or punch somebody and they fall down and become unconscious, what do we call that? Is it A, knock down, B, knock out, or C, knock over? Let me know in the comments what you think it could be. So we've got Afaf going for A, Marco going for A, Rishab going for B, knockout. Okay, we've got Lovegood going for knockout. A and B. So lots of A's and B's coming in. We've got KO from Rindra. Okay. No out. So I think you mean knockout in the second round. So be careful with that spelling. And we've got a knockdown from Penny. Oh, okay. And one more. Okay. I think knockout is the right answer. So we'll stick around. We're going to take a look very, very soon, because that is the end of the quiz section, the question section, and we're going on to the answers. So, well done for getting this far, but now it's important to stick around for this part here. And if you'd like any more information about any of the topics or answers covered here, be sure to check us out, bbclearnenglish.com. We've got loads, .co.uk. We've got loads and loads of materials. We got lots and lots of grammar, vocabulary, exercises, quizzes, videos, lots and lots of things for you out there. Check out our Instagram, check out our Facebook, we're on Twitter, and of course YouTube. With that being said, let's go on to round one. The vocabulary question, looking at which of these is not an Olympic sport. And we looked at there's four choices here: rugby, rowing, fencing, or D, rounders. What do you think? A, rugby, B, rowing, C, fencing, or D, rounders? And the correct answer was rounders. Okay, so rugby is a very popular sport in the UK and around many parts of the world. I am from Wales, it's a very popular sport there. It's a physical sport that involves carrying a ball from your side of the pitch to the opponent's side. Normally, we play with 15 players, but in the Olympics, it's played with just 7 players on each team. If you have not seen it, I highly recommend it. Very fast-paced, very energetic, very physical. So rugby is in the Olympics. Rowing is the sport where you use oars to race boats over, I think it's 2,000 meters to a finish line. Now, this is quite popular in the south of England. And there's, you might have heard of the boat race between Cambridge and Oxford, where there was a rowing competition, a very famous rowing competition. And fencing is when two competitors each have a weapon and they try to hit each other with that weapon on certain areas of the body. It looks like sword fighting. So the one that is not an Olympic sport is rounders. Rounders is a game which is similar to baseball, but it's played mainly in Ireland and the UK, and it uses a bat and a ball, and it's a little bit similar to baseball, but it's played usually in schools and at amateur level, and some of the rules are different. So rounders is not an Olympic sport. Now, did you get that correct? Joshua Josh says, rounders is not an Olympic sport. You are correct. Hello, Maria, Nora, I've learned a lot in this show. Happy to hear it. Okay. Yes, so rounders is mainly popular in the UK and Ireland. And Yelena, do men play rounders? To be honest, it is mostly played at school level. So by boys and girls in British and Irish schools. And actually, the first, it's a very old game. So the first reference to it was in 1744. So we've been playing it for more than 250 years. It's a very old game. Well done if you got that correct. On we go. Question number two. Evgeny, better late than never. No need to apologize. We're glad to have you here. Now, question number two was our idiom question and asked, which idiom means to do something really, really well? Do you A, knock it out of the park, B, smash it out of the game, C, hit it out of the stadium, or D, bat it out of the arena? Okay, A, B, C, D, what do you think? Ta-da-da. The correct answer is A, knock it out of the park. So if you do something really, really well, if you are very pleased with your job and how you did it, you can say you knocked it out of the park. Now, this idiom comes from the sport of baseball, And if you do a good job in baseball, you hit it and the ball goes all the way out of the park. Okay. So we can use it, you know, it comes from baseball, but let me give you some examples of this idiom in non-sporting situations. So my friend Colin knocked the ball out of the park with his presentation at work yesterday. It was so good. One more time. My friend Colin knocked the ball out of the park with his presentation yesterday. It was great. So he did a really good job. Or I can say, good luck in the interview tomorrow. I'm sure you will knock it out of the park. So we're saying we got confidence they will do a very good job. Now, less commonly, we can also say, hit it out of the park. So knock it out of the park, hit it out of the park. The other three, we do not say. We don't say smashed out of the game. We do not say hit it out of the stadium. And we do not say bat it out of the arena. Now, are you enjoying? If so, please hit that like button. Juan has got a lovely comment here. I really like it. No matter if I don't answer correctly, the most important thing is to learn. Absolutely. Tony, good job, Tony. 2 out of 8 already. Well done. Okay. And we've got a happy birthday. Happy birthday to you, Sabir. Well done. Oh, well done. Well done on getting the question right. And happy birthday. I hope you have a wonderful day and weekend planned. And Jiminan, 0 out of 2. That means you've learned 2 new things already. So keep it up. On we go. Question number 3. And question number 3. Another vocabulary question. And it's looking at, again, one of the more negative aspects of sports. And it's the use of illegal drugs in sport. Now, do we call the use of performance-enhancing drugs eloping, A, B, moping, or C, doping? A, eloping, B, moping, C, doping. So the use of illegal or banned drugs in sports, what do we call it? All right. Absolutely, C, says Manuel. I noticed that a lot of you went for C with this one. So I wonder, is this word similar in your own languages? Or where have you learnt these examples from? And we got a lovely comment from Hasnia. So far, I haven't knocked it out of the park. Your comment has knocked it out of the park, Hasnia. So well done. All right. So question number 3. Eloping, moping, or doping? The correct answer was C, doping. Now, when somebody takes a drug that makes them faster or more focused or stronger, we use the word doping. Now, it's a kind of a global problem that affects sports all over the world, really. And we call the drugs or the substances they take performance-enhancing drugs. So, doping. We call the people who try to stop it anti-doping authorities. So a little extra word for you. Eloping is, so the choice A, is when a couple secretly run off to go and get married. So if there's a couple and their parents don't approve or they don't give them permission to get married and they run away from home to do it in secret, we say they elope. So that's eloping. Moping, B, is a term we use to describe someone who's bored and sad. They kind of walk around with a sad face, looking lonely and depressed, and they don't know what to do with themselves. This kind of face, we say they are moping, and often we use it with a collocation with about or around. They're moping about, they're moping around. So if your friend is looking bored or tired or sad or lonely or sleepy, and they don't have anything to do, you can say, stop moping around. Let's go to the cinema, or let's go to the bar, or let's go to the park. Stop moping around. So those are the 3 words there. Did you get that correct? Let's take a look back into the comment section. We've got Salafu. I finally knocked it out of the park. Well done. Yilin says, usually teens will elope. Yes, they will. And Rosaria says, eloping is very romantic. Okay. Let's have a look. So, dopage and dopaire in French. So maybe that maybe that is why so many people have got found that one so easy, if it's sharing maybe the Latin roots. Oh, and Benny's being very nice. Thank you very much, Benny. Okay. And doping is a verb. Yeah, so doping is a verb, to dope. Yes, okay. Okay, good. 2 or 3. Not bad at all. That's pretty good. And adding to Yilin's comment about teenagers eloping, Paul has added, teens also tend to mope around, mope about. Yes, they do. At least according to their parents. On we go. Question number 4. Ah, but okay, grammar question. So by the end of the day, the Olympics, started. So we're looking for the missing words here. By the end of the day, the Olympics, started. Will be, will have been. Now, what do you think? So a nice grammar question here. While your answers come in, okay, we're going to take a look at one or two more example comments from before. So some people are moping around because of the news of the pandemic. Yes, okay, so moping around is when we're bored and we're tired and we're a little bit depressed and we don't want to, or we don't feel like doing anything. So we just can hang about. Okay. Okay, lots of comments saying that you've knocked it out of the park. And we got lots of B's and lots of C's for this particular question. And the correct answer was will have. So well done if you got that one correct. So this was a grammar question. It looked at the future perfect simple. Now, if you can feel confident about making your own examples using the perfect future simple, put them in the comments. And this is when we look at something that will have been completed by some point in the future. So by the end of the day, for example. So at the finishing point, okay, so by the end of today, the start of the Olympics will have been completed. Not the whole Olympics, just the start. So we make the present future simple by using will plus have plus the past participle. So here we've got will plus have plus started. Let's have another example. By the end of the quiz, we will have looked at 8 different grammar and vocabulary points. We will have looked at 8 different grammar and vocabulary points. Hopefully, we will have learnt a lot. So that's the future perfect simple, talking about an event by a certain time in the future. Okay, and let's look at some lovely examples coming in. So Maria Kitchtan, by the end of the session, students will have learned many useful expressions. Lovely example. Okay. By the end of the month, the Olympics will have been completed. Yes. Okay. Akshat, by tomorrow, I will have done my work. Well done. And by the end of this session, says Anagha, I will have learned a lot. Okay, I'm going to take one more. I'm familiar with the feeling on a test or an exam because you've got the choice between two different things, haven't you? All right, so Leonardo's here. Can I hurry up? Well, I'll move on for you. Let's go on to question number 5. All right, question number 5 was Paige's question. I thought Paige was very helpful in the explanation of slang. And she asked this particular slang term. And these 3 choices are all examples of British slang. And they mean, we're asking which one means to be disappointed when you lose. Is it A, gutted, B, chuffed, or C, knackered? Which one means to be disappointed when you lose? And Paige gave the example of last week, you know, that England lost to Italy on penalties. So a lot of England fans will be feeling how. Okay. And the correct answer is a gutted. Now, gutted is British slang. It's mainly used in the UK and Ireland. And we can use it in any situation when we're disappointed about something. But it's definitely common to hear when talking about sports. So last week, a lot of England fans were absolutely gutted when England lost. Be chuffed means that you're really pleased. Yeah, I'm chuffed. Okay, it's very common in some parts of the UK. And we've got a nice video on this, actually. If you search for Dead Chuffed and BBC Learning English on YouTube, there's a nice video. Do it after the quiz, of course. And knackered is common slang to mean very, very tired. Now, as with all slang words, be careful when you use them. They're really, really nice and kind of perfect for informal conversations and text messages with your friends or close family members. But we don't use them so much in formal situations, in business, or definitely not in academic writing. Now, how are you doing? How many have you got? Okay. Laurie didn't know the word gutted. Well, we're happy that we could teach you something new. As Simran has given a lovely example, I was gutted when I was unable to defeat him. Great. We lost the game. I'm well gutted. Nice. Okay. Asena, first time to hear it. Well, we're happy to teach you something new. And Tony says, I was absolutely gutted when I lost the final match in football. What a feeling. Oh, gutted. And Mahasan correctly says, chuffed is the opposite of gutted. Yes, it is. And one final one. I was gutted when I got naught out of 8 questions right. Yes, I can imagine Elin. 1 out of 5, not bad, keep going. And Cosnol, I'm knackered because of studying. Keep it up, you can do it, okay? I know studying is tough work, but it's worth it in the long term. Okay, on we go, question number 6. Vocabulary questions. Okay, 3 sports, I'm looking for the 3 names. There's not a lot I can add to this, it's just vocabulary, so let's go through this. First one is diving. So the act of jumping into a swimming pool is diving. Okay, this is a sport. You dive from the diving board into the pool and competitors are judged on the quality of their dive. Number 2, archery is a sport using a bow and arrow, and the aim of the sport is simple. You've got to shoot arrows as close as you can to the center of a target. In the Olympics, the archers shoot the target from a distance of 70 meters. Wow. And then the sport is volleyball. Now, there are 2 types or 2 main types of volleyball. There's indoor volleyball, which is played on a court inside. And there is beach volleyball, which, as the name suggests, is played on sand. In this year's Olympics, the Olympics will have beach volleyball. Okay. And we got lots of examples coming in. Every day. Well done, Yang Long. Okay. And we got Yosby. Yes, very good. With correct spelling as well. And Neo is a volleyball fan. Okay. So, Neo, diving and driving, very different. So make sure that you spell that correctly. And here, nice question. Instead of does, we'll say, is the center called a bullseye? Yes, it is. Okay. Yes, it is. Is it? Is that right? Good question. Hit the bullseye. In darts, it is definitely. So when we play darts, the middle part is called a bullseye. I think in archery it also is. To be perfectly honest, I haven't done any archery since I was 14, so a long, long time ago. I think so. Okay, thank you, everybody. On we go. Onwards and upwards. 2 more questions. Well done for sticking around. We're nearly there. Round 7 was another grammar question. A little bit of a tough one, but really useful to know. So some events may be affected by the hot weather conditions, A, adverse, B, adversely, or C, adversity. The correct answer is adversely, choice B. Okay, so, but let's look at the sentence here. So, the word that is, so, should we use the verb, the adverb or the noun? Some events may be affected by the hot weather conditions. Okay, the missing word is changing the meaning of the word affected. So, the missing word changes the word affected. What sort of word of is this? Is it a noun? No. Is it an adjective? Not here, it isn't. It's a verb. So affected is a verb, and the word before it is changing the meaning of the verb. So we know this is an adverb. Most adverbs end in ly, so we can take a nice guess and say that adversely is the answer. Well done if you got that correct. Okay. Yes, as we could see, we've got Gilson, an adverb is needed here. So Vijay saying, I'm totally gutted. I'm guessing you did not get that correct. Okay, but nice use of that. And a nice definition here from Anaga, adversely means in a negative way. Exactly. So some events may be negatively affected by the hot weather conditions. On we go. The last question of all. Round 8. So, which phrasal verb means to hit or punch someone and make them lose consciousness? To hit somebody in the face or the head and then make them lose, make them unconscious. On the floor, like that. What do you think it is? Let me know. Okay. Going back a little bit, Paul, is chuffed like thrilled. A little bit, yes. So chuffed is happy. You're very pleased about something. So you can say, yes, I'm thrilled. I'm thrilled to be here. I'm chuffed to be here. Both of them would have a very similar meaning. Huh. And volleyball is the national game of Sri Lanka. Well, good luck to volleyball in the Olympics this year. Okay, lots of people were going for B in this one. Were they correct? Yes, they were. Okay, B, knock out. If someone is punched in the head and they become unconscious, we say they have been knocked out. So you might know this term from boxing where it's KO. KO. So this is an abbreviation of knockout. And in slang, we can also use KO as a verb. So the boxer was KO'd in the second round. So let's look at the other answers. Knockdown has a few meanings. Let's look at two of the most common ones. Knockdown means to demolish or destroy a building. So the old power station in my town was knocked down as it wasn't being used anymore. Or they are thinking of knocking down the market to build some new high-rise apartments. So knockdown is to demolish a building, or it can mean to hit someone with a car. On the way to work yesterday, I was nearly knocked down by a passing car. And to knock over means to push or to hit or to shove something over. So Clara's dog jumped up and knocked her over. She was okay though. Or, I'm sorry, but I knocked my glass over. Do you have any kitchen towel? The difference between knockout and knock over with people is that when someone is knocked out, they become unconscious. If you knock someone down, push them and knock them down, they can get back up straight away. So, did you get that right? How many did you get in total? So, KO'd, yeah, we do K, capital letters, O, capital letters, apostrophe D. Yes, how many did you get? Guys, let's have a look. Oh, nice. Poirier knocked McGregor out and won the fight. Yes, okay. Okay, and I knocked him out with one punch in the face, but not very nice, but nice example sentence. So, yes, to knock down is to demolish a building. Yun, for the rate. Not so bad. Thank you. Thank you for joining. Well done to you. Okay, you seem quite happy with that. So well done. Remember, we're all at different levels, so we're all aiming for the score that we are pleased with. Don't compare with each other. It's what you're looking for yourself. Okay, and let's have a look. Elin says playing sumo wrestling. So were you doing with martial arts and active sports? We do judo or do taekwondo, or we wrestle, or we do wrestling. And let's have a look. And we got Pardon, thank you so much. Mary, thank you. See you next Friday. Yes, so everybody, before you go, one last reminder. On Mondays, we have vocabulary lessons with Phil, 1:30. On Tuesdays, we have pronunciation live on Facebook with either Ian or Rob. Wednesday is a live English grammar class. Thursday is pronunciation live. And Friday, with me, it's the live English quiz, all at 1:30. I'm so happy that you joined me today. I hope you all enjoy the Olympics and enjoy watching the show, and all have a lovely weekend. The sun is shining in Liverpool here, and I'm really looking forward to the weekend. I wish you all a great time too. Okay, thank you very much, everyone. Bye.